The year is 1913, and if you want to send a message to a friend who lives far away, you send a telegraph. But out in Palo Alto, California, a researcher at the Federal Telegraph Company named Lee DeForest has just invented the vacuum tube amplifier. All of a sudden, you can make weak electrical signals as loud as you want, which means long-distance telephone calls and radio broadcasts are now possible. DeForest didn't realize it at the time, but he'd also just set in motion a chain of events that would lead to over $14 trillion worth of startups being created in the San Francisco Bay Area as part of the greatest innovation ecosystem the world has ever seen. But first, right down the road at Stanford University, a professor named Frederick Terman soon begins encouraging his best students to start companies instead of going into academia themselves. He works to connect the students to wealthy individuals and corporations that can help fund their ventures. Terman had seen firsthand how the boundary-pushing research done at universities like Stanford wasn't being applied practically in people's everyday lives. His desire to bridge that gap and accelerate societal progress births the unique culture of Silicon Valley that mixes innovation with risk-taking. He'd later become known as the father of Silicon Valley, and you can see why. The first startups and venture investments wouldn't exist without him. Two of his students were William Hewlett and David Packard, the founders of HP, which is worth $30 billion today. Fast forward to 1957. Terman's ideas are a hit and have attracted many top military-trained engineers to the region to build or join companies after World War II. Yes, it's true. These days, you have Google employees protesting any involvement between big tech and the military, but many of the foundational companies of the Valley were built by ex-military engineers. Anyway, at the same time, two key things happen. First, the government passes the Small Business Investment Act, which means that anyone can raise an investment fund and receive 100% matching funds from the government. Sounds great. But it comes with strict limits on the size of the fund, which limits the upside. It spurs a lot of interest in venture funding, but the limited fund sizes means private funds become major players. Second, this happens in tandem with the invention of the transistor, basically a smaller, more reliable and scalable replacement for DeForest vacuum tubes. One of the inventors was William Shockley, who takes Terman's advice and starts the creatively named Shockley Semiconductor Laboratory to commercialize transistors. However, Shockley is allegedly a terrible boss who doesn't listen to his engineers, and eight of his top engineers leave to form a competing company, Fairchild Semiconductor. Fairchild gets $1.5 million in funding to start the company from investor Arthur Rock, and he names them the Traitorous Eight. This is arguably the first true VC deal, since it's an investment in a company that doesn't have a product or an established business yet. It's seen as the highest risk investment into a startup to date, but Arthur Rock does the deal because he's realized something that no one else has yet. Making money from investing in startups follows a power law distribution, with many failures and a low number of extremely large outlier successes. Most investors are thinking about a typical normal distribution where there are roughly the same number of failures and successes, but not Rock. His strategy lays the foundation for all venture funding, even today. Fairchild ends up being so successful that it births additional companies like Intel, AMD, and more. They were basically the PayPal mafia 30 years before Elon Musk and Peter Thiel teamed up. They also created something called the integrated circuit, basically a silicon computer chip that allows multiple transistors to work together. Integrated circuits form the basis for all computer chips and lead to a reporter named Don Hoefler deeming the region Silicon Valley in 1971. Now, Arthur Rock had formalized early-stage startup investing and understood that outlier success follows a power law distribution. It took a few years, but in 1972, some other people figured it out too. That year, Don Valentine founds Sequoia Capital, and Eugene Kleiner founds Kleiner Perkins, two iconic VC firms that are still leaders in the industry today with billions of dollars under management after early investments in Google, Apple, Amazon, Uber, Airbnb, Twitter, YouTube, LinkedIn, Instagram, Nvidia, TikTok. You get the idea. Initially, Sequoia takes a more hands-off approach, but Kleiner's is slightly different. They'll provide the capital to a visionary founder on the condition that they get to pair them with an experienced and business-minded co-founder. Today, it's extremely rare for a VC to choose your co-founder, but it's the birth of a dynamic that still is very common, where one founder is technical and the other is more focused on the business side. By the mid-70s, momentum in the Valley is building. Intel, a Fairchild spin-off, commercializes microprocessors, which power the first wave of at-home personal computers. And more smart people are following Frederick Terman's vision and choosing entrepreneurship to commercialize breakthrough technologies. Two of those smart people, Steve Jobs and Steve Wozniak, form Apple to build personal computers. And around the same time, Bill Gates and Paul Allen form Microsoft to build the software for both Apple and their main competitor, IBM. The undeniable success of all three companies, IBM, Apple, and Microsoft, is against the backdrop of capital gains tax reductions in the United States from 49% to 20%, which encourages a dramatic rise in the money being poured into venture capital, and therefore the number of startups being formed. While all this was happening, the internet was quietly being created. In 1969, DARPA launched Arpanet, which allowed Stanford, UCLA, and two other universities to break down and send large data files back and forth via a technique called packet switching, where, for the first time, data being sent could be broken down into small parts, making transmission easier and more flexible. It was a fundamental improvement on traditional phone networks, which were built on circuit switching. Researchers Vinton, Cerf, and Bob Kahn use it to create an efficient network called TCP/IP that you might be more familiar with than you think. Your IP address handles the path that data packets take, while TCP ensures they get where they're going and in the right order. VCs are initially more focused on personal computing, but then, in 1989, British CERN researcher Tim Berners-Lee invents the World Wide Web. This fully realizes the vision for what a connected network could be. It uses TCP/IP, but gives every address a more readable name, like google.com, and lets users create custom designed pages using a language called HTML that loads when someone pings their address. You have to remember, before this, there was no such thing as a website, a URL, or a web browser. And so the internet race was on. VCs, who have already started shifting their focus away from hardware and into software, due to it having better margins and therefore lower risk, love the internet's potential. Kleiner Perkins invests in Marc Andreessen's company Netscape, which becomes the dominant browser of the 90s and whose 1995 blockbuster IPO sends shares soaring from $28 to $75 on the first day, and demonstrates to all investors from Palo Alto to Wall Street just how massive the internet could be. As a result, things go a little crazy. VCs are able to raise and deploy billions of dollars into new startups. They're betting that the first new company to tackle every problem on the internet will be successful, rather than waiting to find sustainable business models first. It's a speculative bubble to the degree where companies are able to IPO despite burning millions of dollars a year, fueled just on the belief that the internet will transform everything. But bubbles don't last forever, and by 2000, many internet startups are running out of money. Pets.com spends $4 million on Super Bowl commercials, but goes out of business just 9 months later. The NASDAQ loses 78% of its total value between March 2000 and October 2002. Trillions are lost from investments in companies that were building things despite ignoring the golden rule.
Make something people want.
Many investors get scarred, and unfortunately for Silicon Valley, funding dries up. But not all companies fail. Dotcom era darlings Amazon, Google, PayPal, and eBay survive through extreme determination, a focus on revenue, and restructuring. And the investors who don't get wiped out have gotten a reality check. For the next 20 years, they go back to focusing on business fundamentals as well, not just hype. And it turns out that the internet does have some interesting business models to be discovered. Facebook, YouTube, and LinkedIn are founded as part of the second wave of internet companies. Despite the carnage, there are some people focused on making things that people want. In 2005, Paul Graham, Jessica Livingston, Robert Morris, and Trevor Blackwell launch Y Combinator. Unlike most VCs, they decide to exclusively invest very small amounts of capital in exchange for very small equity stakes, extremely early in a small number of startups' journeys at the same time as each other. And while they don't require any operational control or veto rights, unlike some VCs at the time, they bring the founders together in person and directly mentor them in a batch format. This is a new level of risk-taking that takes the power law to its extreme. YC doesn't need control or big equity stakes. They've understood that investing as early as they do creates an environment where success is binary. Either they're going to make billions on a startup or nothing. And they only need a few to succeed to make their model work. They call it an accelerator. And while unorthodox, their founder-friendly model attracts thousands of applications and is a massive success, leading to the creation of Reddit, Dropbox, Stripe, and many more startups. They also pioneered demo days, where every startup in their current batch pitches to a large number of investors at once. This creates bidding wars and shifts the leverage in Silicon Valley negotiations from investors to founders. For the first time, investors have to fight to get into deals instead of founders needing to fight to get capital. And overall, the capital crunch of the dot-com era doesn't last for too long anyway. Netscape's Marc Andreessen and his co-founder on another company, Ben Horowitz, go on to co-found the venture firm A16Z, and raise millions on the back of the thesis that software is eating the world.
Well, so the bigger one is software is eating the world.
Yes.
Their belief is that it will dominate every industry. It's a venture firm that's designed like Hollywood talent agency CAA. This approach gives founders access to a full stack support system of PR, recruiting, and more, not just capital, and without demanding control. Simultaneously, we start seeing more examples of founders no longer being seen as replaceable by so-called professional CEOs. Instead, Mark Zuckerberg wears pajamas to some pitches. Google plays Sequoia and Kleiner Perkins off each other in a bidding war. And founders like Elon Musk, Adam Newman, and Travis Kalanick are considered central to the success of their startups. The idea is that the founder has more authority at the startup and more skin in the game than any non-founding CEO ever could. This is a complete 180 when you look back at how Steve Jobs had been ousted from Apple 20 years earlier. By the time A16Z announces their first fund though, the world has already changed. Steve Jobs, now back at Apple, launches the iPhone in 2007 and the App Store soon after. It kicks off the biggest shift in consumer behavior since the launch of the internet and opens the floodgates for apps like Uber, Instagram, and WhatsApp. This kicks off another round of money pouring into venture capital, and more so than other industries, tech is largely immune to the Great Recession a year later. Investors can tell that the opportunity is too big to ignore. This time, though, the money isn't coming from just US-based investors. The world has become aware of what's happening in Silicon Valley, and after seeing success after success, international VC firms like SoftBank begin competing aggressively for hot deals. It isn't just international investors who want in, though. The shift to mobile makes it blatantly obvious that Silicon Valley is more than a one-time bubble. And the very technologies that Silicon Valley founders have created make it so much easier for the ideas that power the success of the Valley to spread organically around the world. Silicon Valley's move fast and break things mindset and unique culture combining risk-taking with innovation gains popularity, and startup hubs pop up in China, India, Europe, Latin America, and Africa, along with elsewhere in the US too. It's become clear that the success of US tech startups in Silicon Valley isn't because of geography, though the talent density that's accumulated after nearly a century is certainly going to be hard for anyone else to catch up to. But rather, it's because of Frederick Terman's original idea to combine breakthrough technology with people's everyday lives. And now everyone wants it. The low to zero interest rates of the era mean that investors are more content than ever to deploy capital into high-risk asset classes like startups. And with borrowing costs near zero, investors are willing to take bigger risks on high-growth, unprofitable startups, driving up valuations to unprecedented levels. At times, it borders on feeling like the dot-com bubble again, but this time founders have the leverage. Both the founder-friendly mindset and the free money of the ZIRP era come crashing down though. Unlike the dot-com era, where many startups IPO'd before they were ready, the ZIRP era has the opposite problem. Many founders are preferring to keep their startups private for as long as possible to retain control, which is keeping investors from seeing profits for, in some cases, well over a decade. And the high-profile, controversial ousters of Travis Kalanick at Uber and Adam Newman at WeWork are seen as confirmation to investors who are wondering if founders have too much leverage and are moving too fast, breaking too many things. With interest rates going back up in 2022, the ZIRP era officially ends. However, despite venture funding being down, Silicon Valley itself continues to accelerate. Startups and their founders are more popular than ever. Elon Musk is a legitimate celebrity, and building a personal brand is basically essential for ambitious founders, which is why my ghostwriting agency is helping more founders grow on LinkedIn, X, and with a newsletter than ever before. Check it out in the description. Additionally, Y Combinator's former president, Sam Altman, co-founded OpenAI and has ushered in the largest shift since mobile. But as AI makes it easier to build products with less investment than ever before, what does the future of venture capital look like? We do know one thing though, despite remote work having proven that successful startups can be built from anywhere, the rise of AI has brought most top talent back to the physical Silicon Valley. But over a longer time period, the trend is clear. The ideas and culture that are coming out of Silicon Valley, creating trillions of dollars in value and making massive improvements to people's everyday lives, are changing the world and spreading globally.